perhaps some of you know, 2003 marks the centennial anniversary of Wilber and Orville Wright's historic first flight in Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. We're getting a bit of a jump on the celebrations here by bringing to you one of the world's foremost experts on the history of aviation, and specifically on those two bicycle shop owners from Dayton, Ohio, who accomplished what humans have been dreaming about for millennia. This evening, I have the pleasure of introducing Dr. Tom Crouch. He's a senior curator and chairman of the Division of Aeronautics at the National Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C. Dr. Crouch has been associated with the National Air and Space Museum for almost 30 years. He's also curated such important exhibitions as A More Perfect Union, Japanese Americans and the United States Constitution, at the National Museum of American History, as well as played a major role in opening the Ohio Historical Center, the Neil Armstrong Museum, and the National Air and Space Museum itself. In addition, Dr. Crouch is the author or editor of over a dozen works on the history of aviation and flight technology, including the award-winning The Bishop's Boys, A Life of Wilbur and Orville Wright. His new book, The Wright Brothers and the Invention of the Aerial Age, co-written with Peter Jacob, will be published in May. And he's been telling me that his new book, Wings, also A History of Aviation in the 20th Century, will be out in October. So keep an eye out for that. Human-powered flight and all of its many triumphs and heartbreaks is certainly on our minds this week as we reflect on last Saturday's tragic loss of Columbia and her seven crew members. However, tonight, Dr. Crouch will help us to place this event within the historical context of a long and involved search to understand and harness our abilities to soar through the skies. Tonight, let's hear about these two remarkable men whose perseverance and indomitable spirits have changed all of our lives today. So, without further delay, please help me welcome Dr. Tom Crouch.
Thanks, Caroline, and thanks all of you for coming out on a snowy night, too. I barely made it, and it's good to look out and see some friendly faces out there on this, again, snowy night. As Caroline said, this year we're celebrating the 100th anniversary of the invention of the airplane. At the end of the 20th century, the Gannett newspapers and the museum, which is an institution in Washington, D.C., devoted to the history of news gathering, did a national poll trying to discover what 100 newspaper stories people thought were the most important in the 20th century. And the biggest news story that people selected was the landing on the moon. The next biggest was the atomic bomb. The third was Pearl Harbor. And the fourth was the invention of the airplane. Well, I knew the guy who ran the museum, and when I saw it in the paper, I immediately picked up the phone and called and said, "Don't you guys ever think you couldn't have had the first three stories without the fourth story, for heaven's sakes?" In fact, if you think about the 20th century, lots of wonderful things have happened in this century, breakthroughs in medicine, all sorts of things that have changed our lives in profound ways. But certainly, I think you have to include the realization of the ancient dream of flight as one of those things that literally shaped the history of the 20th century in manifold ways, good, bad. When you step back from those sort of near-term realizations, you know, the airplane changed the way in which we make war, do commerce, transport ourselves, turned us into a world full of jet travelers and all that stuff. When you step back from that, I think it's possible to see flight in larger terms as just sort of a magnificent human achievement. I work, as Carolyn says, at the National Air and Space Museum, and that's always been billed as the most visited museum in the world. We get about 10 million visitors a year. And I've always told people that it's not because we do better exhibits than other museums, it's because of the subject. The subject is one, when you watch people walk in our front door and they see the world's first airplane hanging in front of them, the real thing, and they see Charles Lindbergh's Spirit of St. Louis, the real thing now, and the X-1, the very airplane that Chuck Yeager flew through the sound barrier, and the spacecraft that John Glenn orbited the Earth in, the first American to do that, and the spacecraft that brought my first boss at that museum, Mike Collins, home from another world, along with Neil Armstrong and Buzz Aldrin. It just sort of takes their breath away. I think our museum and the subject itself, again, if you step back and look at it in big picture terms, just sort of makes you feel good to be human. Gosh, fellow creatures of my species did that. They actually figured out how to do that. And we've gone so far in less than a century. So I think all of that is involved when we think about celebrating 100 years of flight. Drop my thing. Can we have the slides? There we go. Okay, now we're ready. There they are. I can't tell what there it is. That's Wilber, the older brother, and that's Orville, the younger brother. Wilber was, again, the older. He was born in 1868 in a little town in Indiana. Orville was 3 years and a few months younger than Wilber was. You can see something about their personalities just looking at them in this picture. Orville was a much nattier dresser than his older brother was. People who knew them say that Wilber tended to be the more serious of the two and that kind of thing. One of the really interesting things about these guys is how ordinary they seem to be on the surface, and yet how extraordinary they were in fact. If you had lived next to them in Dayton, Ohio, the city where they grew up, in 1900, when they were first becoming interested in flight, you would have regarded them as the most ordinary guys in the world, good neighbors, good family members. They were living in their father's house. Neither of them ever married. Small businessmen, honest as the day is long, all of that sort of thing. Lots of great things, but you never would have picked them out as two guys who are going to realize the oldest technical dream, perhaps, in the world. The desire to fly goes with us, with human beings, all the way back as far as we can trace it. Some of our earliest religious stories, mythological stories, legends involve the gift of flight. Icarus and Daedalus, of course, on the screen is the classic legend of flight. And all of us have heard stories, I think, about people over the centuries who made wings and jumped off towers and churches and that kind of thing, and usually did themselves great bodily injury. In fact, the invention of the airplane didn't start with those legends. It starts in a really kind of surprising place with very ordinary people doing really kind of playful things. We never give play just the whole notion of play and toys and that kind of thing enough credit for innovation in the history of technology. But in fact, it's had an extraordinary influence. And that's especially true with the airplane. This guy that you see on the screen, this is a 14th century an illustration from a 14th century Flemish manuscript. And you see this. The artist didn't quite understand how this toy actually works. The guy's hand should actually be holding this bulbous thing. And he's going to pull that string, which is wound around that shaft. And, of course, when he does that, that helicopter blade is going to go sweeping up and bumping against the ceiling. It's the oldest powered flying machine that we know anything about. It's a toy. But it's where this story actually begins, and in a much more serious way than you might think. These toys continued to be developed over the succeeding centuries, and they inspired one generation of youngsters after another to take an interest in flight. At the beginning of the 18th or the 19th century, as we'll see in a second, they inspired a fellow named Sir George Cayley, who really takes the first serious steps toward the invention of the airplane. And during the latter part of the 19th century, they inspired a couple of guys named Wilber and Orville Wright. Their father, who was a church bishop, came home. They were living in Cedar Rapids, Iowa at the time, with a little helicopter toy, the latest version of this original toy that he had found somewhere in his travels and he brought home for his boys. And it absolutely reached out and grabbed them by the collar. When people in later years asked them how they had really gotten their first interest in flight, they always talked about that little helicopter toy. And their nieces and nephews, decades later, were still running around chasing the little helicopter toys that Wilbur and Orville had made for them. They made these things throughout their lives. So this one little toy has an extraordinary impact. Kites, too. This is a peculiar kind of medieval European kite. I really can't imagine the invention of the airplane without the kite. We tend to think of kites as toys today. But in fact, over the centuries, kites were the only heavier-than-air devices that were capable of sustained flight that you could really count on. When you come to the 19th century, kites are the models for the first airplane wings. They enable experimenters to test all kinds of aerodynamic notions, and they enable Wilbur and Orville Wright, as we'll see, to test their control system, ultimately. So, again, it's another apparently simple technology that was absolutely essential to the invention of the airplane. And here's another one, a little more useful, perhaps. This is another medieval illustration of a windmill. You see it right over there. People, I think, connect the notion of an industrial revolution strictly with the 18th and the 19th century. In fact, there were many industrial revolutions taking place during the Middle Ages, spawned by new methods of producing power, specifically windmills and water wheels, powering all sorts of industrial processes. And the windmills and the water wheels were especially important because, again, they were economic devices. People were using them to make a living. It's really important to make them more efficient than they are now so they work better and make more money for you. And it was the business of studying exactly how windmills and water wheels work, the earliest studies in fluid dynamics in a lot of ways, that laid the groundwork for the invention of the airplane directly. I guess when people think about the invention of the airplane, they tend to think that it was the work of scientists. Well, it really wasn't. It was the work of engineers. The people who invented the airplane really couldn't explain to you, they couldn't walk to a back blackboard and explain to you at a fundamental level why the thing worked. What they had done was to gather data, which is what engineers do, that can be applied to understanding a device and improving its design and that sort of thing. And the invention of the airplane really begins in the 18th century with engineers like the Englishman John Smeaton studying windmills and trying to improve them, gathering data. At the very end of the 18th century, the early years of the 19th century, this guy came along. His name was Sir George Cayley. He was a member of the minor nobility in Great Britain. He was a baronet. His seat was a place called Brompton Hall in Yorkshire. And George Cayley was one of those early 19th century Englishmen who was interested in science and technology in very general terms, but he was especially interested in flight. He was just absolutely fascinated by flight. One of the reasons Cayley is often recognized as the father of aviation is because he's the first guy who looks back over a century of information gathering, again, people trying to improve windmills, gathering data about the performance of windmills and water wheels, and says to himself, hey, I could use this data on windmills to design a flying machine, an airplane. And he is the first guy to use the tools of 18th century engineering to gather data that's specifically going to be used for aeronautics. This is a thing, this is his drawing, of a thing called a whirling arm. You see a weight down here running over a pulley, and to this spindle here. Of course, what they're going to do is release the weight, and when it falls down, this thing is going to whirl around, and these are test surfaces. He's going to be able to take basic measurements on the forces operating on those surfaces as they spin through the air. Again, this is a device that was originally developed in the 18th century to study windmill blades and so on, and he's applying it for the first time to flying machine designs. He's not only the first guy who specifically gathers data and thinks about it in terms of airplanes. He's also the first guy to build what we might recognize as a modern airplane. This is a later version of a model that he developed originally in 1804. And it's simplicity itself, but sophisticated simplicity. You'll notice this. It has a wing. And what's really important about it is that it's separate from everything else. It's not a propulsion source. This is a glider. So gravity is the propulsion. That wing is fixed. This glider has separate systems for lift, for propulsion, and the separate system back here for control. And that's the beginning of thinking about modern aeronautical design. He not only did that, he's also, in all probability, the first guy to actually send human beings aloft in heavier-than-air machines. And this is one of the machines that Cayley is supposed to have flown a young boy in later on in his life. Cayley lives into the 1850s, and he's doing a lot of these experiments toward the end of his life. So he really is the guy who sets 19th century interest in aeronautics in motion. And he sort of frames the problem. And the people who come after him literally recognize that they're following in George Cayley's footsteps. Some of the people in the 19th century attempt to carry Cayley's work forward with models, and that's what this thing is. It looks a little odd. That's a chair. It's sitting nose down on a chair. And the wings, of course, and the tail, that's a steam engine, and these are propellers that are going to be driven by the steam engine. That little steam engine, in fact, still exists in our collection, in the collection of the National Air and Space Museum, even though this was an English invention developed by a fellow named Stringfellow. Other people skipped the model building part and went straight to building full-scale machines that they thought would solve the problem. This was developed by a guy named Clement Ader, who had been a telephone pioneer in France. And it literally did hop off the ground for a short distance in 1890. The Wright brothers weren't the first guys to leave the ground in a heavier-than-air machine. They were the first guys to really fly one. Two or three people had done this in the 19th century. The problem was, you know, they would run down a ski jump or bounce over a bump or something. They would only be in the air for a few yards. The flight was unsustained. Their power plants were always way too weak to keep them in the air, and they were always uncontrolled. There was never a way to control these things in the air. And the awful truth is, and this is true more often in the history of technology than people like to admit sometimes, I think, if guys like Clement Ader had never pounded the first nail into their machines, Wilber and Orville Wright would still have invented the airplane and first flown it on December 17, 1903. In other words, a lot of these guys have no impact on the invention of the airplane, even though they're quite well known today. The people who did have an impact, again, were engineers. Going back to the 18th century, these guys who had gathered data. One of the things that's happening during the 19th century is that people are developing better machines for gathering data. Whirling arms are eventually going to go out of fashion. And the wind tunnel, for example, is invented by an Englishman named Francis Herbert Wenham in the 1870s. And airfoil shapes like these, developed by a guy named Horatio Phillips, another Englishman, begin to be developed in the second half of the 19th century. People are really crunching numbers now. They're testing surfaces in wind tunnels, and they're really gathering data on what kind of airfoils generate more lift and are more efficient less drag and that kind of thing than others. And finally, people are nibbling around the edges of control. This is a little gadget that was developed by a Frenchman named Alphonse Pinault. And in fact, he's actually the guy who built the version of the little helicopter toy that the Wright brothers' father gave them in 1878. Pinault's influence was, again, to get people to think about the notion of how you would control a flying machine in the air. Control was a huge problem. So by this time, you're in the 1890s. A whole century has almost gone by since Sir George Cayley. And people, as you can see on the screen, are actually flying. This is a guy named Otto Lilienthal, who was a German pioneer, mechanical engineer, who had taken an interest in flight in the 1880s. And like Cayley and the other smart engineers who were interested in flight during the century, he had conducted a whole set of laboratory studies of his own, again, gathering data about the lift and drag generated by various surfaces in a fluid stream. And he had come up, he'd written a book, and with all of that done, like Sir George Cayley, again, he turned from research to a different and more active kind of research, actual flying. People, as I said, had kind of bounced off the ground at various times during the 19th century, never very effectively. Lilienthal was different. This guy began gliding in 1890. He was killed in a gliding accident in August of 1896. And between those two dates, he made about 2,000 glides. And as you can see on the screen, this guy's really flying. There's no doubting the fact that he's actually in the air. But you can also see his problem. This is his body. This thing is a hang glider. The only way he can control the motion of this machine is by shifting his own body weight. What he's trying to do is to control the center of gravity of the machine. He's trying to keep the center of gravity under the center of pressure. He's been flying along like this, and he's been struck by a gust on one side. So this starts to happen. The only way he can control himself is by throwing his weight, as you see, toward the high side to pull that wing back down. That's why it's called a hang glider. His body has to hang underneath it to make the system work. And it did work from 1890 to 1896. Again, unfortunately, as I said, he was killed in August 1896 because when everything was said and done, it didn't work all that well. The center of gravity of aviation crossed the Atlantic in the 1890s, actually after Lilienthal's death. The guy you see on the screen now is an extraordinary fellow named Octave Chanute. We have one of Octave Chanute's relatives in the audience tonight, in fact. As you can see by this picture, which was taken in the 1890s, he was in his 60s when he actually became serious about aviation. And at that point, he was one of the most successful civil engineers working in the United States. Flying was his hobby. And at this age, he began to take his hobby seriously. Chanute had always been a member of scientific societies and engineering societies. And so when he became interested in flight, he tried to do what he had done as an engineer. He wrote letters to other flying machine experimenters all over the world and started to gather information about what other people had done. He published his book in 1894, a book called Progress in Flying Machines, which was actually a history of prehistory of aviation up to that point. And like Lilienthal, when he had done that, he decided to move ahead and actually try flying himself. Could we focus it a little better, do you think? These are slides that he took, and they aren't real clear, but you can get some notion. Chanute didn't actually fly himself, although that's him in this glider. This is his biplane glider up here, and that's the tail back there. And he flew with colleagues, associates, at the Indiana Dunes, where Gary, Indiana, is today, on the southern shore of Lake Michigan, just east of Chicago. And he was extraordinarily successful. This is a picture of that glider that we just saw actually in the air. And there were other Americans who were interested in flight, too. This is a guy named Samuel Pierpont Langley, who was running the institution I work for in 1896. He was the secretary of the Smithsonian Institution. The head of the Smithsonian is called the secretary. Langley was self-trained as an astronomer. But like Chanute, he'd become fascinated by flight and decided to spend what time he could spare from his other pursuits fooling around with airplanes. He started out with models. He started out building small models like this one. Again, you're looking at a sort of formal scientific picture of it. That's the nose, that's the tail, the props, and it's powered by rubber strands. And, of course, it's just covered with material that we'd call microfilm today. But he started out that way. And by the spring of 1896, he was actually flying airplanes of the sort that you see here on the screen. This, which he called an aerodrome, this is aerodrome number 5, had a wingspan of 15 feet. And that was about 15 feet from nose to tail. So this was a big airplane, not big enough to carry a human being, but it's powered by a steam engine here. And the steam engine drives propellers. And that's the Potomac River down there. He launched it over the Potomac River. So between Lilienthal and Chanute and Langley, lots of stuff is going on. The whole notion of flying is in the wind. And people are wondering what's going to happen next. And along come Wilber and Orville Wright. At the time they become interested in flight, they're running a bicycle shop in Dayton, Ohio. And they're known as being extraordinarily mechanically talented guys. One of the problems I think that people have when they think about the Wright brothers is that they tend to think about them as talented bike makers. Well, that's what they did for a living, but in fact, they were far more than that. These guys developed a process for solving technical problems that sort of is a model of a kind of engineering method. They had all kinds of talents that had remained hidden, but which in fact were going to enable them to sail way beyond much better educated folks who were looking at the airplane problem and come up with solutions, see it in a unique way that no one else had seen before. I have a friend with whom I've helped fly replica Wright gliders for years, Rick Young. And Rick says, you know, when the Wright brothers begin at the in 1899, 1900, you might as well call them the Wrong Brothers, because everything they think is true is actually wrong. And the story of the invention of the airplane is actually the story of the way in which they disentangle that, correct their own misunderstandings, misapprehensions, and move forward to solve problems that no one else even knows exists. And you can see that in the beginning. What they did in the spring of 1899, when they first became interested, they wrote to the Smithsonian asking for advice as to what they should read about flying machines. And the Smithsonian sent them a bunch of stuff. And they read it, and they said to themselves very quickly, they analyzed the problem, and they said, you know, Langley and Chanute and Lilienthal and those guys actually built wings that carried some pretty heavy things into the air. So people must know a lot about wings, and we'll be able to use that data to build our wings. Propulsion, the second part of the problem, we don't have to worry about now. They decided they were going to follow Chanute and Lilienthal, and they were going to build and test gliders so that they could learn to fly themselves while they were in the process of solving their technical problems. So they say to themselves, you know, people are fiddling around with lightweight engines for automobiles and motorcycles and whatnot. And when the time comes that we need an engine, the technology will be there. So they totally ignored the engine for the moment. And that left one of Cayley's three original problems, control. And they recognized that control was the one of the key aeronautical issues that no one had laid a glove on. And so they immediately said, okay, what we are going to try to do is to develop a control system that will enable a pilot to keep maintain absolute control over an airplane every second it's in the air. Most of the guys we've seen up to this point, again, it killed Lilienthal, weren't taking the control issues seriously enough. What Wilber and Orville said from the outset was, the heck with this hang gliding stuff. We are going to develop a mechanical system that will enable us to change the geometry of the wings so that we will be able to maintain absolute control every second we're in the air. That's the only safe way to do this. So they start with control. And they immediately have this sort of epiphany. And they say to themselves, well, you know, control in pitch, you know, nose up, nose down, is not going to be all that tough. We can use a horizontal surface at the rear of the airplane to do that. Control in yaw, nose right, nose left, isn't going to be too difficult. Ships have had rudders as long as there have been ships. The tough one for an airplane is roll control, because you have that other dimension that other forms of transportation don't have. How do you keep the wings balanced? That's what killed Lilienthal. What they come up with is what you see on the screen. This is a drawing of a little kite that they built in 1899. It's only, again, that's about 5 feet. It's quite small. I have a little replica of it that I actually fly. And this center drawing shows you how it works. Those are the operator's hands. He's got his hands like this on these two sticks. And what's going to happen if he forces his thumbs forward, that top wing is going to go forward, or backward, rather, of the bottom wing, and the thing's going to nose up. If he pulls his thumbs back, then that top wing is going to slide forward of the bottom wing, and the thing will nose down. But the neat thing is, if he turns his hands in opposite directions, like this, what he's going to do is throw a twist like that across the entire wing. And when he does that, what'll happen, if you'll imagine this is the right end of the wing and this is the left wing tip, when the wings are warped, that's going to happen. Now, in this case, this wing has got a positive warp and this one's got a negative warp. So this one's going to generate more lift than this one. And so what's going to happen, ideally, is that if you're flying along and you're struck by a gust, you can do that and restore yourself to balance. And that was the Wright brothers' starting point. Octave Chanute, whom they came to know, who became sort of their best friend in aeronautics, gave it the title wing warping, and that's what we still call it today. I'm a native of Dayton, in fact. I was born there. And I can tell you it's not a very windy place. The Wright brothers were self-trained engineers, and part of what that meant was that they were going to calculate exactly how their craft was going to perform before they took it out to try it. They were going to calculate exactly how much surface area it was going to take to lift the predicted weight of the machine in a wind of a particular velocity at a particular angle of attack. And when they ran that simple calculation, what they discovered was that you either had to fly in a pretty high wind or you had to have a huge wing surface. And they were worried about a huge wing surface. So they began looking for really windy places. Chanute had flown, as I said, on the dunes at the southern end of Lake Michigan. And in fact, Chicago, it turns out, is one of the windiest cities in the country. Buffalo's another one. When they looked, they wrote to the Weather Service and got a list of average wind speeds at weather stations all over the country. And the windiest places tended to be places like Chicago and Buffalo, the urban places. And they didn't want to fly in an urban place. They didn't want to have to fiddle with newspaper reporters and that kind of thing. The sixth windiest weather station in the United States in 1899 was right there. Kitty Hawk, North Carolina. It's a little place that nobody had ever heard of except the people who lived there. But there was this tiny little weather station which one guy manned part-time so that his data went to Washington And that's how the Wright brothers discovered the place. And it sounded like just the place for them. You have to understand, these guys were small businessmen. They had gone to the World's Columbian Exposition in 1894. But beyond that, they'd never traveled a great deal. And this airplane stuff was not only something that really fascinated them, but it sounded like a real adventure, too. They were going to a pretty wild place where they had never been, and it just sounded like a real scientific vacation, which is what they called them. They decided, when their kite worked, they decided they'd build a full-scale machine. And this is the machine that they took to Kitty Hawk in 1900. They would go to Kitty Hawk, you understand, just for a few weeks. It was their scientific vacation. They'd build this thing in Dayton and ship the parts south and do the assembly and cutting and fitting that they had to do on the Outer Banks. And when they finally got to the point of trying to fly their very first full-scale machine, what they discovered was a problem. It developed about 20% lift, less lift, than their calculations had predicted. So much less that you could really never fly it with a pilot on board except in a virtual hurricane. Now, I think a lot of people would have walked away from the problem at that point. Something's wrong here. We don't understand it. There's a real problem here. The Wright brothers weren't like that. What they did was what you see on the screen. Rather than abandoning the thing, they got a fish scale, and they attached the fish scale to lines that they were going to use to fly this thing as a kite. So they were getting total force on the machine when it was in the air. They had a way to measure the angle of attack, the natural angle at which the glider met the wind. And they had an anemometer to measure the wind speed. And using those elements and some simple geometry, they could literally calculate exactly how much lift and drag the thing was generating. They didn't have to guess or use anybody else's data anymore, which is what they had used. They had used Lilienthal's data to develop these early machines. And even at this point, they were already recognizing that there was a problem with that inherited data. Again, it's one of those mistakes they have to untangle. On the last day at Kitty Hawk in 1900, Wilber really did make a couple of glides, but only a couple. They went back the next year in 1901 with the machine that you see here on the screen. That's Wilber on this side. And you can see how much bigger it is, about twice as big almost, than that first 1900 machine. This time, they could get into the air and make flights. But they discovered that the problem of 1900 was still there. They were still getting a whole lot less lift than their calculations had predicted. And when they went back to Dayton in 1900, they were a couple of literally fairly discouraged campers. They didn't give up, though. Their friend Octave Chanute had invited Wilber to come to Chicago. Even if they were going to drop out of aeronautics at this point, he'd invited them to come to Chicago and give a talk to the Western Society of Engineers about the work they had done to date. And Wilber really wanted to do that. He wanted to capture everything they thought they'd learned in a paper, and if they were going to quit, at least that would be there for other people. But in the process of doing the paper and thinking about all this stuff, they ultimately said to themselves, well, I wonder if we go back to ground zero, if we dump Lilienthal's data and everybody else's data, I wonder if we could collect our own data on the performance of airfoils in a fluid stream. This is just a simple machine that they used to double check the fact that there was a problem with the data they'd been using. This is a wind tunnel that they used to gather their own data. Essentially, they dumped the numbers, the coefficients for lift and drag that they had inherited from people like Lilienthal, and they gathered their own data. Beginning in November of 1901, using this device. The wind tunnel itself is nothing. It's a wooden box, empty, 6 feet long with a fan on one end. This is what it's really all about, the balances that go inside the tunnel. The Wright Brothers balances you could hold in your hands. It looks big on the screen, but it's actually made out of hacksaw blades and bicycle spoke wire. When the whole thing's broken down, it fits in a shoebox. And what they're doing, I'm not going to explain all of this to you, but it's at this point that you can begin to recognize how much more they were than just a couple of lucky bicycle mechanics. That's the wing surface they're going to test. The wind is flowing this way through the tunnel. And when the wind flows over this airfoil, of course, it's going to move, and the forces generated are going to be translated down through this apparatus and read on this quadrant down here. This thing is so, I'll just say this, it is so well designed. They're looking for something that won't mean anything to the non-engineers in the crowd. A couple of little numbers, coefficients of lift and drag. And suffice it to say that this balance drops out precisely the number they're looking for. It's an incredible achievement, and truly incredible. And this was the result. This is their 1902 glider. Remember this glider. Now look at this one. Look at the aspect ratio. The aspect ratio, of course, is the ratio of the chord, the width of the wing to the span of the wing. This is just a lovely machine in the air. And for the first time, it does exactly what it's supposed to do. Now it's right on the numbers. They're getting precisely the performance that their calculations had predicted. And they've put a rudder on the machine to deal with another problem that I hadn't told you about, but it's another change to this machine. This is, in many ways, the Wright 1902 glider, the world's first airplane. This is what they patented. The Wrights never did patent a powered airplane. They had set out to develop a machine that could be controlled every second it was in the air, and they had achieved that with their 1902 glider. And when the time came to get a patent, after they had flown under power, their patent attorney said to them, you know, power just obfuscates what you've really done. Patent the control system. That we can protect. And that's precisely what they did. Just an extraordinary machine. They flew it for 2 years, 1902, and they flew it again in 1903 when they were putting the powered airplane together. This, of course, is the world's first powered airplane, the airplane that hangs in the Milestones of Flight Gallery at the National Air and Space Museum. And again, like all of the others, it was built in Dayton and assembled in Kitty Hawk. It's much bigger, much heavier than any of the gliders had been. The engine is something about the 1903 airplane that everybody always focuses on. They went to their mechanic in the bike shop, a machinist named Charlie Taylor, and Charlie helped them build the engine for the 1903 airplane. And he gets enormous credit for that, which he deserves. But what the Wright brothers always told people was, look, we didn't invent the internal combustion engine. And in fact, our first engine wasn't much to write home to mother about. This was the real problem, their propeller. They had always assumed that when the time came to build a prop, they could go to the Dayton Public Library and get a book on marine engineering and see what it had to say about ship screws and transfer that into this other medium, air, and they'd be good to go. But what they discovered was that the design of ships' propellers had always been so empirical that it was of absolutely no value to them. So they came up with a theoretical approach to propeller design. They reasoned that a propeller isn't really like a screw screwing into wood. What it really is a wing. Instead of moving forward, it's rotating. And as it rotates, it generates lift. Instead of lifting the airplane up the way it does when it's a wing, it'll push it forward. If it's a pusher propeller, as theirs was, and that's a pretty simple way of saying it. In fact, the propeller was one of the most extraordinary achievements on the airplane. A friend of mine tested a 1904 Wright propeller in the big wind tunnel at the Langley Research Center last year, and they discovered that that 1904 propeller had about 81.5% efficiency. A standard wooden propeller that you see on a light airplane today, the few of them that still have wooden propellers, run about 84-85% efficiency. So you see what the brothers accomplished at the very beginning. This is sort of the business end of their airplane. That's Charlie's engine, and these are the instruments, the few instruments they have. That's an anemometer and a stopwatch and the readout for the anemometer. This is a hip cradle. They had to have a way to warp their wings, remember, like their glider. So what they do is lay in this hip crater. This is the front end, and that's where their feet go. And so that cradle, their hips are in that cradle, and they just shift their hips back and forth. And it's a closed loop, so when they move their hips, they're actually pulling wire through the airplane system that warps the wing, and that's how it worked. And this little handle in front is what works the elevator. They weren't the only ones who thought they were ready to fly in 1903. This is Samuel Langley, whom I showed you a few minutes ago. Langley didn't, and this is a guy named Charles Matthews Manley. Langley didn't stop in 1896 when he flew his big steam-powered model. The government, during the Spanish-American War, had given him $50,000 to build a full-size airplane model of the aerodrome that could carry a human being. And by 1903, he was ready to test it, and Manley was his pilot. And unfortunately, that's the last picture ever taken of Langley's great aerodrome. He tested it twice over the Potomac in 1903, and both times it failed catastrophically. Manley survived both times, but the airplane didn't. Langley was ridiculed in the press and became the butt of all sorts of congressional jokes and how much money had been wasted on the thing and so on and so forth. Now, 9 days later, in almost complete secrecy, Wilber and Orville Wright flew at Kitty Hawk. And this is the extraordinary picture taken at that moment, actually taken by a Coast Guardsman named John T. Daniels, who used to help them. Since Kitty Hawk is sandy, the airplane doesn't have any wheels. It runs on this little monorail track into the air. There are little bike wheel hubs mounted down the center line of the airplane. And Orville made the first flight at about 10:35 that morning. And Wilber, who's out here, made the next. And they took turns four times. This is a picture taken close to the end of the third flight that day that you don't see as often as you see the famous picture. At the end of the fourth flight, which was Wilber's turn, he had kept it in the air for 59 seconds, almost a minute. It was long enough to convince them that they had done it, that they had achieved sustained flight. But when Wilber set it down at the end, he came down a little hard, and he cracked the thing up here that holds the elevator. And it was going to take them a few hours to fix that. So they carried the airplane back to the starting point, and they went into the shack to warm their hands up. And when they did, a gust of wind came along and flipped the airplane and destroyed it. So the total history of the world's first airplane was four flights between 10:35 and noon on December 17, 1903. Orville rebuilt it in later years, and it's that we have at the National Air and Space Museum. They realized that they had done it in their heart of hearts. They knew that they were there. But they also knew that 59 seconds wasn't going to sort of cut their time to the coast by very much. So what they decided to do was to change their minds about flying in Dayton. They built a new airplane in 1904 and a third airplane in 1905. And they found a cow pasture outside Dayton where, with great difficulty, because of the light winds, they were able to continue their work. And in fact, by the end of the 1905 flying season, this picture was taken in 1905, that 59 seconds at Kitty Hawk had become, a very long period of time. They were capable of going up and staying up as long as the gas and oil held out and performing any sort of reasonable maneuvers that they asked of the airplane. And essentially, the story's complete at that point. It hadn't taken very long when you get right down to it, from their kite in 1899 to the practical airplane of 1905 was just 6 years to solve a problem that had baffled much better trained minds for a good long time. The brothers don't actually emerge as great heroes until 1908 for a whole raft of reasons that we can talk about if anybody wants to ask questions about it. But we've been here about an hour, so I'll quit with the slides now and see if anybody does have any questions. Can we bring the lights up? There we go. Yes, sir.
Could you finally put to bed the claim of Gustav Whitehead?
Yeah, I can, but Gustav Whitehead fans may not agree with me. The gentleman asked if I can put to bed the claims of Gustav Whitehead. Gustav Whitehead was a German gentleman who had immigrated to the United States via Brazil and had knocked around. He was in Pittsburgh for a while. And he wound up in Connecticut, and the story has many bits and pieces, but at the kernel of it, the core of it, Whitehead is supposed to have made a flight of 7 miles over Long Island Sound in August of 1901. And the flight was reported in newspapers, and in later years, there were lots of people who said they had seen him do it, and so on and so forth. So why don't we agree today that Gustav Whitehead invented the airplane? Well, it's because I just don't think the story's true. I think there's a kernel of truth in it. Whitehead clearly was interested in aviation. He had clearly built engines. He had built a machine. Before the supposed flights of August 1901, Langley had actually sent a crew from the Smithsonian up to Atlantic City to look at Whitehead's airplane when it was exhibited at Steel Pier. And they came back saying, gosh, the thing's too light. It's never going to fly. People have been arguing. Whitehead was forgotten initially. And a reporter who wrote a book about him in the 1930s sort of reignited interest in Whitehead. And it continues in some circles down to today. The honest truth is, I think the stories of the flight itself were a hoax at the core. I think the eyewitness testimony, people who were interviewed in the 1930s about something that they thought they had seen when they were young children in 1901, is, I think, just the kind of eyewitness testimony that's not very trustworthy. Whitehead immediately abandons this design that he's supposed to have flown 7 miles, and he picks up on an idea of Octave Chanute's and does something completely different. There are just lots of pieces of evidence to indicate that it just didn't happen, that it was a hoax at the core of it. And there's no solid information to indicate that it did happen. But there are people who would argue with me about it. Vehemently, I might add, that there are lots of people, there are lots of claims for people who are said to have flown before Wilber and Orville Wright. And Whitehead is sort of the most interesting of all of them. Most of them are just dead irrational. Whitehead's you have to struggle with. But again, I think there just isn't evidence to suggest that there was anything there. Yes, sir. If you look at the Wright patent, the patent focuses on wing warping, but it also describes what we now call ailerons. The word didn't exist when their patent was granted, or when they applied for their patent in 1903. It actually did exist when they got it in 1906. But that notion of small surfaces on the trailing edge of the wing that can be controlled, da-da-da, is actually in their patent. Although, in fact, wing warping isn't completely dead. People still make use of that kind of notion. I was out at Dryden Flight Research Center a couple of weeks ago, and they're fiddling with something that they call an aeroelastic wing. It's an F-18. When the F-18 was brand new, it had wings that deformed all too easily. So they went back in and they beefed up the structure, and it turned out to be a good airplane. What they did with this airplane was to take that extra structure out so that the wing was more flexible again, and they built a mechanism into it so that they could use that flexibility to actually control the airplane. And they're fiddling around with that as we speak. It was pretty neat to see. People misunderstand wing warping and the whole notion of ailerons. In the very beginning, wing warping was the right way to go. The right structure, that heavily braced biplane structure, so that they've turned the whole set of wings into a beam, and it's got a torsion tube that's just enormous, and yet you can deform it at will by pulling the lines through it, is really an incredibly elegant approach to that problem. Just after the Wrights, monoplane designers especially turned to ailerons, and it just drove them crazy because monoplane wings at that period were very thin, and they were very poor structures, easily deformed and all that. And with ailerons on them, when you actuated the ailerons, they would often deform the wings so that you would actually get aileron reversal, and the airplane would do precisely what you didn't want it to do. And so that's why airplanes like the Blériot, for example, which is the first airplane to fly across the English Channel, are wing warping airplanes too. Yes, sir. No. When you think about the Wright brothers' story, they really. Kitty Hawk was absolutely essential to their success, or someplace like Kitty Hawk. They had to have the wind, and the soft sand didn't hurt any either. And they had dunes that they could make glides from. It was just a perfect place. As I said during the lecture, I have a friend who's been building replica Wright gliders that we've fiddled around with for a quarter of a century now. And the only place we have ever flown them is on Jockey's Ridge at the Outer Banks. You can't fly at Wright Brothers National Memorial anymore because they planted grass all over it and ruined it. But 4 miles down the Outer Banks, there is the largest sand dune on the East Coast, Jockey's Ridge. And they teach hang gliding there today, in fact. But that's the only place we have ever flown those replica gliders because it's the safest place. The notion of trying to fly those things over real dirt, something that's hard when you land on it, is frightening. It's a perfect place to do it. The more interesting question, again, I'm from Dayton, and those folks will occasionally ask if they could have done it if they'd been from any place other than Dayton. And I think the answer to that is that there were other, just as there were other places kind of like Kitty Hawk, there were other places like Dayton. But while they needed the wind and the sand and all that of Kitty Hawk, they also themselves had to come from an environment that was urban, that had machine shops, hardware stores, machinists, foundries. The engine of the 1903 airplane is cast of aluminum, which was difficult to do in 1903. You had to have that kind of capability down the block. And, I mean, people to talk to. And if you think about this country, right then, at the turn of the century, those little Midwestern towns like Dayton were the perfect places to be. You know, Dayton was the center of precision machining, manufacturing, cash registers, bicycles, automobiles, farm machinery. And other little towns in that part of the Midwest were doing the same thing. So you had the small town atmosphere, but what was for the period, real high technology. And they had to have that too. Yeah. Yeah, Dayton.
Here you have just about 20 miles from where Wilber was born, Clessie Cummins was born.
Right.
And he was the same kind of inventor.
Right.
And you had the year that Wilber was born, you had the bridge over the Ohio and Cincinnati.
Right.
I mean, the whole thing was a perfect place.
Again, all of that's in place.
People,
yeah.
Who were peaceful.
And again, working with cutting-edge technology. These, I mean, if you think about things like cash registers and bicycles, that kind of production was the cutting-edge production of the period. Absolute precision machining, absolute interchangeability, all that engineering, all that kind of stuff. And as the gentleman points out, I mean, Dayton was also the town that was going to produce the, you know, the electric self-starter and all this other stuff that came out of it right around the time that the Wright brothers were active. Yes, sir?
There's some discussion I've read recently that the Wright aircraft, and specifically the first powered aircraft, are difficult to fly, whether because of control issues or stability issues, I'm not certain. Can you comment?
Yeah, they're unstable airplanes, especially the 1903. I mean, if you look at it, the elevator is right on top of the pilot. There's no movement arm at all, and the rudder is right up there, too. And trying to stay ahead of it is probably real difficult. Although I think people take that too far sometimes. I have a friend, Fred Kulik, who's one of this nation's great aerodynamicists and teaches out on the West Coast. And Fred has been interested in Wright technology for a long time and did some wind tunnel studies a few years ago. And he's one of the guys who wants to build a replica 1903 and fly it this year. So he had done the wind tunnel studies, and he took that data, and they put it into the flight computer of the airplane that they use to teach shuttle pilots flying. You know, they can program the computer so that the thing will behave like the space shuttle and so on. Well, they tried to program it so they thought it would behave like the 1903 Wright Flyer. And to make a long story short, none of the test pilots could fly the thing for any time at all. I don't really think I trust that. I don't think it's going to be all that difficult. Orville, I mean, when he talked about it in later years, said, look, it was tough to fly, but we always thought the big problem with the 1903 was the fact that we only had four shots at it and it was broken. We always thought that if we'd been able to continue flying it and learn from it, then, you know, we would have stretched our time in the air and all of that kind of thing. In fact, he actually said at one point that he thought If they'd been able to practice, they might have been able to keep it in the air for 20 minutes, half an hour, and get up to 1,000 feet and so on. I'm not sure that's true either, but the truth is somewhere in there.
Why did it take them so long to find out, you know, when did it break into the news?
I didn't say much about the Wright brothers' personality or about the way in which they grew up. They grew up in a house. Their father, as I said, was a church bishop who was involved in lots of problems with his church. After rising to the rank of bishop over a period of 10 years in this church, he started nibbling away at a little theological problem that most people thought was really small potatoes. But he dug at it for another 10 years, at the end of which he led about 10% of the total church membership away in a schismatic church, turned around and sued the other 90% for possession of church property in cases that wound up in 7 state Supreme Courts. He lost every single case. Bishop Wright was a guy who raised his children to recognize that, you know, there was temptation beyond the family hearthstone, and people were lying in wait to capture you out there, and family was what you had to stick to. These were guys who didn't trust the world in general. And so they decided that, well, okay, we've got this thing. And the reporters were showing up again by 1905 when they were in the air for half an hour and so on. And so they said, okay, that's it. We're not going to fly anymore. We'll get our patent, and we'll sign a contract with somebody who wants to buy the thing, and then we'll fly it again. And that didn't happen for almost 3 years. They didn't fly. From the fall of 1905 until March 1908, not once did they fly. They wouldn't show initially their potential customers, they wouldn't even show them pictures of the airplane in the air because they were afraid that somehow the secret might get out. It's just the way they were. So it's not until 1908, the spring, that they have their patent and those signed contracts. And people are, they're finally willing to pay them to go out and fly, and they do it. And that's when they become world famous. 5 years after they flew at Kitty Hawk, 3 years after they made the big flights in 1905 at Huffman Prairie. It's their personalities are very much a part of the story, much more so than I indicated here tonight. As Caroline said, a biography that's almost 11 years old now, although it's still in print, called The Bishop's Boys. And I called it The Bishop's Boys because of my own firm belief that their father was an extraordinarily important part of this story, just because of the way in which he shaped his children. Yes, ma'am. Yeah, they did. Wilbur dies in 1912. Orville lives until 1948. Orville doesn't fly very much. I don't think he flies at all after 1917. But they fly beginning in 1908 in Europe, in America, all over the place. They train other people to fly, all of that kind of thing. They are their father's sons, though, and they become involved in patent suits. And the patent suits become more important to them than pushing the technology. And so gradually, by 1910, 1911, they've fallen well behind the curve in terms of flight technology and are less important than they once were.
One more,
okay, yeah.
In their wind tunnel studies, was there a problem of scale of extrapolating the coefficients they got from models up to real?
No. And again, when you look at the way in which the balances work, no one, and I mean this is something that people have looked hard at, are really sure whether this was, it's hard to believe that it was conscious. I think it was accidental. But they developed both the lift and the drift, the drag balance, in a way that sort of Reynolds numbers out of the business, so that the coefficients they were getting were immediately useful. They could count on them.
A little serendipity in there?
I think so. I think that's it. There are people who think that they figured the thing out. John Anderson, who used to be chairman of the Aero Department at Maryland and who's a colleague at the museum today and who knows a whole lot more about wind tunnels than I do, has looked hard at it, and he's pretty sure it is serendipity. But again, when you really analyze the balances and how they work, for an engineer, it is sort of breathtaking. It's at that moment that you say to yourself, you know, these guys, there's a reason why Wilber and Orville and not Samuel Langley or Octave Chanute or somebody. These guys really did have the ability to come at problems from unexpected and enormously useful angles, to see things that other people hadn't seen, to transfer from one technology to another. They just had some real innate capabilities.